Afternoon, everyone. Thank you for having me. As Tanya said, my name is Pippa Ehrlich and I'm a film director based in Cape Town. So almost 4 years ago, my team and I started working on a passion project known as the Octopus Teacher. At the time, we had a few hard drives filled with underwater footage, absolutely zero budget, an edit suite in an attic, and a very obscure storyline about an animal that isn't exactly known for its cuddle value. Our team consisted of a producer who hadn't made a film in 10 years and a director who'd never made a film that was more than 10 minutes long. The odds were stacked against us, but we were determined to complete this project because it was burning a hole inside our hearts.
I remember the day when it all started, seeing this really strange thing. A lot of people say an octopus is like an alien. But the strange thing is, as you get closer to them, you realize that you're very similar in a lot of ways. It's a hard thing to explain, but sometimes you just get a feeling and you know there's something to this creature that's very unusual. There's something to learn here. I had to have a radical change in my life, and the only way I knew to do it was to be in this ocean with her. And then I had this crazy idea. What happens if I just went every day? A line that can't be crossed. You start thinking about your own vulnerability, worried about your family or child. I hadn't been a person that was overly sentimental towards animals before. I realized I was changing. My relationship with people, with humans, was changing. What she taught me was to feel that you're part of this place, not a visitor. That's a huge difference.
Four years later, we're only just getting used to the idea that we are riding the crest of a wave that is far bigger than we ever imagined was possible. Our film is available to over 200 million Netflix subscribers in almost every country on planet Earth. It's been dubbed into 32 languages. Celebrities and global conservation icons have commented on our work. We've won more than 20 international awards. Our organization, the Sea Change Project, has risen from complete obscurity to global fame, as has the Great African Sea Forest, the ecosystem that we're trying to protect. And we've been shortlisted for two of the biggest film awards in the industry. I cannot fully explain how all of this happened, but what I would like to share with you today is why we decided to tell this story in the way that we did. Because it involves a process of intense reimagination. In terms of my own capacity to carry things through, my relationship with the natural world, and the way that I craft the stories that express that relationship. As a case study, I'd like to begin with this. This seemingly fantastical and barbaric law was declared in 1668, and it is in fact the first conservation law to be made in South Africa. At the time, there might have been many indigenous communities carrying out conservation practices. But as far as conservation legislation is concerned, this is where it all started for South Africa. These early settlers had some foresight about our little African penguins because the flightless birds were very early easy pickings for those early colonizers. fast forward 322 years and you get me, fresh out of Joburg on my first day at the beach. This was shot at Boulder's Beach, and I wish the frame was a little bit wider, because if it was, you'd see that I was surrounded by little African penguins. For a child from Joburg, these yearly pilgrimages to Simonstown were a kind of psychic transformation for my child mind that have quietly shaped the adult that I've become. Someone who is dedicated to connect to nature and cannot imagine a world without wilderness. In the city, I was anxious and claustrophobic, but on these breaks in wilder places, I got a sense that there was a different way of being in the world. My story was an extremely fortunate one, but for animals like the African penguins, a terrible tragedy has played out. In just my lifetime, we've seen a 60% decline in these penguins. And the same is true for many, many of the animals that we share our planet with. And that begs a very crucial question. If the first conservation law ever passed in our beautiful country, full of magnificent birds and beasts and mythical forests, was made to protect penguins, then where are we going wrong? Of course, the causes are complex and compounded, but as human beings, we're made for solving problems. We've sent rockets into space and invented nuclear energy. We've explored the depths of the oceans. So one would think that saving flightless birds would be a relatively easy task. But when it comes to the rampant biodiversity loss that we are experiencing all across our planet, what do we need to do differently? In my early 20s, I traveled throughout Southeast Asia and Southern Africa and saw for my own eyes oceans devoid of fish and skies without a single bird. I started asking myself some very dark questions about our future on planet Earth. It became clear to me that although very good and important conservation work was being done, it wasn't happening at a scale or speed that we needed it to if we wanted to protect the planet that we are completely dependent upon. Biodiversity has continued to disappear at a terrifying rate. For us as human beings, this is a big problem, not just because animals are fascinating and magnificent, but because biodiversity is in fact the immune system of our planet. It is these massively complex communities of animals and plants that keep ecological systems stable. Perhaps the best example of what happens when the system starts to break down is the rise of zoonotic diseases. And every human on planet Earth now has a sense of what it means when those systems start breaking down. If we want to save ourselves and the millions of creatures that we share our world with, we need a radical systemic change. And for many of the years in the early phases of my career as a conservation journalist, I became obsessed with reimagining an approach to conservation, and more specifically, conservation storytelling. My first eureka moment happened one morning in Joburg. I was working for a creative agency at the time, and I went to a market research presentation by a company based out there. And I was kind of wondering what on earth I was doing at this presentation. But then the organizer showed us a video that completely changed the way that I thought that human beings think. Filmmakers visited neurologist after neurologist all over the world and gave them an A4 sheet of paper. Then they asked them the question, what percentage of human decision-making is governed by our rational minds? And one after the other, each neurologist drew a tiny shape on the A4 page, no more than 4 or 5%. And then it dawned on me. Most of the time, as human beings, we don't think with our heads. We think with our hearts and our bodies and our deep evolutionary instincts. What that means is that our behavior is not being governed by the information that we hear, but rather by the feelings that are running through us, even without realizing it. What that meant for me was that behavioral change, key for managing how we treat the world around us, cannot be achieved with information alone. And this was quite a dark realization, because as a journalist, I'd been trained to rely on facts. My entire profession was dedicated to finding those facts and representing them as accurately as I could. And the same is true for biological scientists, who are possibly the most important people we have in our world when it comes to understanding conservation and conservation challenges. So for me, this was a critical clue in understanding why, despite 400 years of conservation legislation, we are failing to protect the system that keeps us alive. Conservation scientists are doing their jobs. Much of the time, they understand the problems faced by the natural world and have already found the solutions. But somehow, they've struggled to find the political will and public support to create any real-world change. I realized then that I needed to find a way of telling stories by communicating not just to people's heads, but to their hearts. And then, 4 years ago, a story presented itself to me in the form of an often invisible creature. This is the octopus teacher, and this is her home, the Great African Sea Forest, a vast underwater forest found at the very tip of Africa. From annual holidays as a small child, I now spend almost every day of my life here. I started freediving in the sea forest about 14 years ago. But in those days, I was terrified of the cold. I wore a thick wetsuit with 10 mils of neoprene across my chest, and I enjoyed chasing large, charismatic animals through the forests, like these big seven-gill sharks. I wasn't very interested in the more subtle aspects of the environment. My reimagination of a kelp forest happened about 4 years ago when I was invited on a very different kind of dive. A friend of mine, Ross Freiling, who co-founded Sea Change with Craig, had been telling me for months about the magical experiences he was having when diving in the cold without a wetsuit. I was interested to see what he was talking about, and so I asked to be invited on a dive. And then one morning, I found myself sitting in a parking lot, looking out over a pretty cold gray sea and sky, feeling very, very anxious about going into that water wearing nothing but a bikini. I was also surprised when our guide, Craig Foster, led us into a sort of shallow, barren-looking area where I didn't imagine we would find much life. The next 40 minutes were nothing short of spooky. I found myself staring into the eyes of small bottom-dwelling sharks. I saw cryptic animals that I never knew existed. And Craig was in tune with hidden details in nature that I would never have noticed. Here you can see the tiny arm of an octopus growing back next to its fully established arms. In that moment, despite the fact that I thought I knew this place and had been diving here for many, many years already, I started seeing it with new eyes, and the kelp forest became transformed into the mythical golden forest. At the end of the dive, something especially strange happened. I was standing in very shallow water, and I looked a few meters ahead of me and saw a tiny creature swimming gently at the surface. I put my hands out and stood absolutely awestruck as the animal swam straight into my hands. This is called a dark shy shark, and this little guy can't have been more than a week old. It struck me, I mean, I was actually working for a shark conservation organization at the time, and despite all those years of diving in the kelp forest, I'd never seen one this tiny. And what was even more surprising is these animals hang out on the bottom, they're benthic. So to see one swimming across the surface like that just was very, very strange. And all kinds of questions started racing through my mind. So I was hooked and I was intrigued and I wanted to know more. And I asked Craig if he would spend some time teaching me how he was finding all of those weird and wonderful animals in the forest. What I didn't realize is by asking that question, I was signing up for a kind of deep nature initiation program. Step one was reimagining my relationship with the coals. It wasn't easy. At the time, it was late winter. The water was between 12 and 14 degrees, and I had a full-time job. So I spent many mornings sitting morosely on the beach, looking out at a cold, dark sky and a freezing cold ocean, dreading getting in. And once I did eventually move myself into the water, I saw very little, because I spent most of that time thinking only about how cold I was and wondering how long I had to stay in before I got out. And as soon as I hit the 20 minutes mark, I was out of there. That went on for about 2 months, but then I had a breakthrough. This shot was taken on the very first day that I managed to stay in the water for over an hour. I can't really say what happened that day. Maybe it was the light filtering through the surface or the fact that the water was crystal clear. But somehow, I was just brought into this deep, deep space of presence and aliveness. And what happens in the cold is it does bring you into a state of complete and utter presence. And I felt like the kelp forest was coming alive inside of me. I got out of the water and pretty much giggled all the way home. And my friends who'd been wearing wetsuits just looked at me as if I was crazy. I got home and spent the rest of the day in bed because I pushed myself a lot harder than I should have. But something had switched inside of me, and I felt like I'd unlocked a kind of superpower that I never dreamed I had. This was the first of many superpowers that I would discover over the next 4 years of my life. Now that I could keep up with him in the cold, Craig and I started diving together regularly. And I asked him if he would teach me to track. I also started filming. So Craig had spent many years in the Kalahari learning to track with master sand bushman trackers, and he was applying what he'd learned to the kelp forest environment. The first thing I realized is that the kelp forest is one of the most cryptic places on Earth. When you look at this image, you might not see it, but there's a large clipus sitting upside down on this very, very encrusted kelp stipe. If you look at the top, at the middle left, you can see the animal's eye. When it comes to tracking, it works in layers. At the beginning, you only see the very obvious things, like slime trails left by mollusks when they move across rocks. Then you start to see the more subtle things, like limpet teeth tracks on kelps of stipe, sometimes even in the rock itself. Tracking also allows you to see backwards in time. When you look at the shell, you can see what this animal was eating at different phases of its life because of the different colors in the shell. You can also find animals by finding their eggs. When you find an egg mass like this, you don't need to look too far before the animal itself is revealed. And then you get to the very subtle things, slight impressions in the sand that reveal sand clipfisses hiding just below the surface. Slowly, slowly, I started to decode the kelp forest ecosystem, and the more I learned, the more fascinating it became. It was about 6 months into this progress. It was about 6 months into this process that Craig told me about his octopus teacher. He told me the story and asked if I wanted to be involved in the film. I read the treatment at my desk and just started crying. And I was crying for two reasons. Firstly, the story was so profound and resonated me on a level so deep that I couldn't help but burst into tears. And secondly, I was crying because I realized in that moment that my life was about to change drastically. We had no budget and no guarantee that we would be able to finish this film. But somehow I just knew that I had to do it. I also knew that that meant I was going to have to give up my very cushy job at an NGO with a CV office in Cork Bay and a guaranteed salary at the end of every month. But I said yes. And in doing that, I signed up for 4 years of being utterly out of my depth and in icy, icy cold water. And that's not just a metaphor. Craig wanted this filmmaking process to be true to his practice, and so we agreed that as much as possible, we would shoot the film with no wetsuits and no scuba gear. And this brought me to my biggest tracking challenge, trying to find an underwater magician. And as you can see, it's no small feat. Octopuses really do know how to blend into the world around them. But in time, you learn to get your eye in and find the shapes of their eyes or their suckers sitting on the outline of whatever substrate they might be on. The best way to find an octopus, however, is to look through their trash. So when octopuses catch their prey, often shellfish, they collect them and take them back to their den and then drill a small hole through the shell that allows them to immobilize the animal and eventually get it out. So what happens from the surface is you'll look down and see what looks like kind of a shelly debris around a central point. And often the octopus's den is in that point. That's what the holes in the shell look like. Learning to track octopuses was not an easy process, and it took about a year before I could really do it well. But that was much easier than figuring out how on earth we were going to tell the story. We had thousands of hours of footage and two lifetimes to fit into a 90-minute cut. The life of a 50-year-old man, Craig Foster, and his almost daily dives with an octopus that happened over the period of a year. We had a huge library of blue chip footage combined with things that Craig had filmed himself. And matching all of those camera formats turned out to be one of our biggest challenges as well. So in case you don't know the story, 5 years ago, on his daily dives in the kelp forest, Craig met this fascinating little octopus. He didn't know what it was about her that drew her in, but something just made him think that there was something he could learn here. And so he visited her every day. At the beginning, she was shy and hid inside her den, but eventually he won her trust and she started to reach out. And this is a very kind of surprising thing because an octopus is essentially a snail that's lost its shell in evolution. And they're known to be very antisocial creatures. But in time, she let Craig in. She reached out, and not only did she reach out, but she started coming out of the den right in front of him. As she let Craig into her world, she revealed things to him that he never dreamed were possible, and also things that had never been filmed before. She showed him how she hunted for crustaceans, like lobsters and crabs. She helped him discover a new species of shrimp, which is only found inside the den of octopuses. And most fascinatingly, she showed him how she managed to cope in a world full of predators, particularly these very aggressive little sharks known as pajama cat sharks. Because these octopuses have lived in the kelp forest for millions of years, they've developed pretty ingenious strategies for surviving and outfoxing their predators. In this picture, you see how the octopus has wrapped itself up in a kind of kelp basket for protection. Here, she's using the transformer technique, which involves lifting hundreds of shells and stones around her body as protection. And this, one of the craziest things I've seen, octopus cowboy, where the animal will climb on top of the predator's back behind the head where they can't get them. And this has been seen with octopuses all over the world. There are photographs of octopuses climbing on the backs of dolphins and covering their blowholes. So once we started telling the story of the octopus, it kind of began to tell itself. Her life was so fascinating that the story just unfolded in a very natural way. But we really wanted to get inside what makes an octopus. And so to figure out how these animals think, we contacted Professor Jennifer Mather, who is almost certainly the only octopus psychologist on planet Earth. She's a professor of human psychology who also specializes in cephalopods. We flew her out to South Africa and she watched our cut frame by frame and helped us decode what we've begun to call octopus language. So the first thing you realize is that these animals can not only blend into the world around them, but they're very good at pretending to be something that they're not. In this photograph, the octopus is saying to you, basically, I don't know what you think I am, but I'm not an octopus, and I suggest you move away quickly because you don't know what I'm capable of. Here, she's being big and intimidating by flaring her arms out to their maximum width. And in this image, she's moving in exactly the last way you expect an octopus to, flaring her arms out and walking away on two legs. This is an octopus's chief strategy for being terrifying. They create large, dark eyes across their heads that make them seem like a much bigger animal than they really are. And one of their most ingenious tactics, pretending to be a rock, and then folding their legs underneath them and carefully moving along the seafloor. So here we were with a fascinating subject and a very compelling storyline. But despite that, we found ourselves firmly stuck in the mud. Our distribution partners were shopping the project to broadcasters all over the world, but one after the other, we found ourselves being rejected. And this was a very scary place to be, because at the time, we'd been working for over a year with zero funding. I'd pretty much moved into Craig and his wife Swati's basement. And there were weeks when I didn't have enough money to put petrol in my car and drive home. And I started wondering kind of what we were doing wrong and why the film wasn't working. And eventually I realized that this really was a problem in terms of our approach to storytelling and that we needed to reimagine our storytelling format. At the time we had a cut that was fairly traditional in the fact that although Craig was telling a very personal story, he'd been narrating it in a voice of God style format. And somehow the voice of the film just wasn't working. It wasn't coming through with the kind of authenticity that we needed it to. I tried to do interviews with him very early in the process, but at that point I already knew him too well, and somehow those interviews just didn't work. And so we were very lucky that we got the cut in front of a man who had just the right imagination for the job. This is my co-director, James Reed, and we spoke through the film over and over again and agreed that the best approach to take moving forwards would be for him to come to South Africa as a stranger and interview Craig. And that's exactly what happened. He came out to Cape Town. We sat down for 3 days and went through one of the most grueling interviews I've ever seen. And he managed to get Craig to express himself with that kind of vulnerability and openness, which I think is what makes the film what it is. I ended up going back to Bristol with James, and we worked tirelessly for 2 or 3 months and got a new rough cut together. And then we experienced a Christmas miracle. The woman on the left of this frame is Sarah Edelson, and she is our executive producer at Netflix. The woman in the middle of the frame is Ellen Windermuth, our EP from Off the Fence. Just before Christmas, Ellen managed to get the film in front of Sarah. And Sarah was flying back from Hawaii, where she'd been on holiday with her family, just after Christmas. She just happened to open her laptop as the flight took off and push play. And for the rest of the flight, she was completely transfixed. And not just her, her 8-year-old son, who was sitting next to her, was equally mesmerized. And so, just like that, Sarah flew to South Africa to help us work on a Netflix deal. And next thing we knew, that's exactly what we had. And I remember on the day that we got the call feeling absolutely ecstatic, because this is what it felt like we'd been working for all this time. But a couple of days later, I woke up in a state of complete terror. Delivering a film to Netflix is not a small undertaking. At this time, James Reed had to return to the other projects he was working on in the UK. And so it was going to be up to me to deliver this film as the director. And it wasn't just delivering the project that was scary. When you've been working on something for so long and it's so close to your heart and you realize that it's going to go out to an audience of 200 million people, it's a terrifying, terrifying thought, because you feel like your heart and soul will be on display. And for Craig, who was actually in the film, it was an even more terrifying prospect. The next 9 months were some of the hardest of my life. I made a new friend who I'd never really encountered before, known as imposter syndrome. I woke up every morning, looked in the mirror, and asked myself what the hell I'd gotten myself into and who I thought I was to have taken something like this on. On most days, I wished the ground would swallow me up, and I wasn't the only one who was struggling. On the right of this frame, you see my friend Kevin Smuts, who was the composer for our film. Kevin and I are exactly the same age, and both of us felt completely out of our depth during this process. At the same time that I was sending cuts through and having them neglected by Netflix, he was being made to rewrite and rewrite and rewrite all of the music that he was composing. Quickly, our project started falling behind. And I remember driving to meetings at Kevin's studio, and I'd never directed a composer before. And I'd arrive 15 minutes later and sit in my car and cry just to cope with what was going on. And eventually I'd stop and wipe the tears off my face and put on a smile and a false air of confidence and decisiveness. And then I'd walk into the studio and start telling Kevin what we wanted from the music. I was in the dark and I needed a friend. And so one day I arrived at the home of one of my best friends, and I said to him, I just don't think I can finish this project. I don't think that I can carry on. And he looked at me with a steely determination and a deep kindness. And he said, you have to finish this project, and you are going to do it. And you're going to do it by engaging your whole heart. And this really struck a deep chord for me. And I went back to the thing that had inspired me in the first place. You know, my adventures in the natural world. And every day I went into the kelp forest, I kind of tried to carry that feeling back to the edit suite with me. And somehow I found the strength to calm myself down and return to the attic. And at the same time, Netflix delivered to me a secret weapon, or kind of fairy godmother, in the form of this woman, Jinx Godfrey, who's really one of the best editors on our planet. So at the time, I was editing and directing, which is a very difficult thing to do, which I wouldn't recommend to anyone. But Jinx sat with me every day, hour after hour, day after day. She was in the UK, and we had these long WhatsApp calls where we discussed the cut frame by frame, and bit by bit, scene by scene, it got better and better and better. And Netflix got happier and happier and happier. And eventually we were at the point where we had a cut that was almost ready for delivery. And then we were faced with a final dilemma. The countdown was on, and we still hadn't decided on our ending for the film. There was a lot happening in South Africa at the time. One of the big problems was the fact that whales were being entangled by octopus traps in False Bay. And the other thing that we'd learned about was that South Africa's ocean territory has been earmarked for mining. 98% of our ocean territory is up for exploration. And our team started to panic, and we kind of erupted into debates around whether this film should become an issue-based campaign film, and whether we should tackle these things in quite a traditional, aggressive way. And once again, you know, and as you can see, there are many, many threats that face the kelp forest. And this was a time when I really had to go back and engage my whole heart again, because although I agree that these are very important issues, and there are many films that tackle issues in this way, and they're very important films, I felt like the story that we were telling was very, very special because it had heart, and because it was universal, and because there was something in there that could speak to every single human being, no matter where they lived or what they cared about. And so I decided we needed to stick to the core of our story, which was this idea of what you can learn and how you change when you connect to the wild in this way. And after almost 3 years at that stage of staring into octopus eyes, I felt like the wisdom we were looking for lay in the story of the octopus herself. And this brought us to perhaps our biggest teaching from the octopus teacher. And it's something that only happens right at the end of an octopus's life. What happens is at a certain point, they choose to mate. And after they mate, a female octopus will go deep inside her den and make the ultimate sacrifice. At this point, she lays thousands and thousands of eggs. A third of her body weight is lost just to go to the creation of those eggs. And then she sits inside her den and quietly blows oxygen onto the eggs, keeps them clean, and makes sure that no predators enter the space. She's so in touch with her babies that if she feels like she's fading away too fast, she can send chemical signatures to the embryos, motivating them to develop faster. Eventually, when the babies hatch, the female octopus is so weak and almost senile, and after she emerges out of her den, it's really just a day or two before she dies. What I realize is that the success of cephalopods, and an octopus is one of many cephalopods, is that they are very tuned into the environment around them. And unlike our own species, that is creating a world where we're polluting our rivers and our air and the soil that we need to grow our food, octopuses are really thinking about the future and thinking about the animals that come after them. They are biologically wired to do this. And I felt like that was really a universal message that every human being could connect to, because every parent loves their child. And somehow the message got through. So where are we now? Well, for a start, we're on Netflix. As I said earlier, when our film launched, it created a wave across planet Earth. Celebrities like Zach Braff and my conservation heroes, men like George Monbiot and Jane Goodall, were tweeting and commenting on our work. This is something I never thought I'd experience. The image that you see on the left is the emailer that gets sent out to all the Documentary Academy members in America and the UK at the BAFTAs and the Oscars. And this is something that Netflix sends to them to motivate them to vote for our film. And we've now been shortlisted, and we'll hear on the 15th of March whether we have an Oscar nomination. And from a conservation perspective, it's also been an enormous miracle. For a start, we've changed behavior. The morning after the film launched, we were receiving an email every 3 seconds. Many of those emails were from people all over the world who'd said that after seeing our film, they would never eat octopuses again. Other emails were from parents who were mailing us to say that since seeing the film, they are making an effort to take their children into nature every single week. Others were from marine biology students who, in 2020, were feeling so sad and disillusioned about the world and the state of our planet that they decided to give up their profession. But after seeing the film, they'd been motivated to carry on. And for sea change as well, everything's changed. Many of the emails we received were from massive marine conservation organizations who we'd been trying to get in touch with for years and years and years, but had never responded to our emails. Now, they're all knocking on our door. What does this mean for sea change ourselves? And I think what it really comes down to is the fact that what we've realized as an organization is that although our goal is to protect the sea forest, what's important is to realize that everything is connected to everything else. And this is a concept that's really embodied in something that Craig talks about in the film, known as Forest Mind.
And now I know how the helmet shell is connected to the urchin and how the octopus is connected to the helmet shell. And as I draw all these lines, all these stories are just being thrown up. It's almost like the forest mind.
So what our organization is trying to do is ensure that the kelp forest can become more resilient by protecting it in every way that we can. And we decided to take kind of a broad level systemic approach. And the first thing we wanted to do is make sure that in order to protect the kelp forest, people knew about it. And so we came up with this idea of the Great African Sea Forest. So what we're really trying to do is make the Great African Sea Forest into a global icon so that it holds a place in people's imagination in the same way as the Amazon or the Great Barrier Reef or the Serengeti. And with the release of the film, we're already a giant step towards making that happen. As you can see here, we have Time magazine referring to the Great African Sea Forest. The core of our work at Sea Change, however, is storytelling. And what we've tried to do with this film is not just share the life of a liquid magician and her magical underwater kingdom, but also explore a much deeper message that really embodies what Sea Change is all about. The intrinsic connection between people and nature and the personal transformation that happens when you really immerse in wilderness. When it comes to emotional storytelling, film is the ultimate medium. It's an alchemy of sound and picture, fact and fiction. And it gives us the power to tap into that subconscious, emotional, and instinctive place that other mediums just cannot go. The making of this film was truly experiential. We were literally dreaming, breathing, loving this project. Every day I went into the water, I came back and brought those experiences back to the edit suite, hoping that when people watched the film, they would get their own glimpse into deep nature. And that's really what we tried to express with my octopus teacher, and I believe ultimately the reason that we were successful. So this brings me back to the subconscious world of a very mysterious creature, the human being. This is part of the Linton panel, one of the most famous rock paintings on Earth. The lines that you see connecting the people to the animals are known as the ropes to God, and they symbolize the great ecological network that we've been part of for millennia. This network doesn't just connect us on a physical level. At Sea Change, we talk about emotional ecology, and this refers to the subliminal emotional connections between people and the natural world. So, and that's what we're trying to express as an organization. So the big question is, can we reimagine the way that we engage with our planet? And I don't know the answer to that, but I would like to share with you what I've learned. What's exciting is that every single human being is part of the story. Each one of us has a relationship with the natural world, whether we're conscious of it or not. And what I really discovered in the making of this film is that to do good things, you need to work as a kind of hive mind. Every single person who got involved was absolutely critical for the collaborative process. And every single human being has their own brand of magic and brought their magic and their talent into the making of this film. And that's the truth. Whether you work in science or business or teaching or medicine, every single person on Earth has a contribution to make towards ensuring that we reimagine the future and create the world that we want our children to grow up in. And that's really, really important. And this is we are at an absolute tipping point in time. But we're now at a point where scientists agree this really is our last decade to change the systems that we have in place and the way that we manage our planet. It really is our last chance for reimagining. But it's a pretty exciting place to be as well. Thank you for listening.